Hey everyone, I hope you're doing well. Welcome to another episode of EphemRadio. It's Ephemeral Rift, and of course, I decided to throw this podcast up on the YouTube channel as well. So in case you're listening, you can always tune in there. Of course, you might see it there. I'm not really sure if all the listeners of the podcast also are viewers of the channel. So in this episode, I want to talk about The Walking Dead. Also a little bit about anxiety that I deal with, just real briefly. Talk about how I recommend YouTube or podcasting for, you know, for anyone that feels the need, the desire to express themselves. You know, even if you're just doing it once, just to, you know, try it out. Talk about free education just a little bit. Just my my mindset in regards to that. And then we're going to talk about philosophy. I recently purchased Thus Spoke Zarathustra by Friedrich Nietzsche. So I want to talk a little about that, why I bought it, and what I'm looking to get out of philosophy, you know, what, you know, why philosophy is important to me and things like that. Share a little information about that in case you can relate or you're looking to, you know, into that as well. Talk about the recent State House of Pennsylvania voting for the legalization of medical marijuana. So I'm going to share more thoughts about my support for psychoactives, and talk, see if I can talk about family as well in regards to time and the cost. And I think that might do it. So first off, I'd like to welcome you. Those, new viewers of the channel, listeners of the podcast. This is basically something I've wanted to do for years. And I started it last year, but I wasn't very consistent. So big apology for those tuning in who wanted me to be more consistent. I'm trying to do that, trying to get on the horse and keep things rolling here on a weekly basis. But yeah, this is kind of an evolution of the Let's Talk videos that I've done. So I decided to put this back up on the channel, and it's not going to be an ASMR format, as you can hear, since podcast formats are really meant to, you know, meant to not really put folks to sleep. So that's, you know, this is not going to be, this is not really meant to be the most popular video in the world, but I'm throwing it up here for those that like to listen to the listen to these things, and I thank you. And those that want to, you know, listen to them here on the channel, instead of having to maybe go over to the podcast. So hey, I can't put these up on Spotify, it's been asked of me before, because Spotify doesn't support. Well, they support podcasts, but you can't submit them. Apparently, from what I understand, they select podcasts that they wish to distribute, or however they work. But you know, we'll see what happens in the future. Even though my videos aren't music really so much, or the audio from my videos, it's somehow I can still submit them. But if I was to submit, try to use the service to circumvent and somehow submit my, you know, podcasts in like the vocal or the spoken word genre, you know, don't want to do that. I'd rather wait until Spotify officially supports podcasts so I can get it listed as a podcast. And it is March. It's Monday night. I think it's the 21st of March. This podcast was supposed to be out the Saturday before this, and I actually sat here for an hour, almost hour and a half, recording. And nothing recorded. Once again, this happened to me before. The piece of equipment wasn't plugged in correctly. Thought it was. The little jack was sticking out a little bit. So here I am again. And I'm going to try to get out the Arkham Sanitarium podcast. That's probably going to be late because I'm hopefully going to be out of town this weekend coming up to work on another project with another someone. I can't believe it's almost the end of March. I'm so glad the nice weather and spring is here. I don't mind winter. This past winter for us was very mild. I mean, we got dumped on like almost 2 feet of snow, but it was nothing really. There wasn't any ice storms or high winds in conjunction with that that causes a lot of power outages, and it was a pretty mild winter. So I was just about to knock on wood on my desk here, but so we were quite lucky. And winter can affect me. I know cloudy days can affect me in my mood, not to the extent of in the past where I used to get depressed. I mean, I don't think it would actually trigger depression. I'm not going to say that. I know there's that seasonal affective disorder. But it could be summer and it could be dreary out and rainy, and it can still kind of affect my mood. I love it when the sun's out. I definitely feel complete difference, energized, upbeat. So it's kind of interesting. I always thought about that from a biological aspect, if there's something to that. But I never looked into it further. I'm no expert. And I feel like, you know, spring's here, and just, you know, when you're young, you know, in the days of our youth, the summers, the days just seem so long. Perspective, right? When you're so little, everything is big, and everything, you know, driving somewhere for a half an hour as an adult seems like hours for a kid when you're little. And, you know, the same with I just have fond memories of endless summer days as a kid and as a child. And even though I went through, you know, some tough stuff in my youth, I don't know, I still had something in me that was resilient. And I was still able to find some happiness, even though often my days were marred with depression and suicidal thoughts. It wasn't every day, and I wasn't suicidal to the point where I needed to see someone. Anyway, I don't want to go on too much, but I do want to really quick talk about two psychiatrists or therapists that I ever saw in my life. And this was actually, just took it upon myself. This was in my 30s. I went to see one, and after I opened up my life story, you might have heard this story before, because I was, you know, having been bullied and just having, you know, no satisfaction creatively, not happy with jobs. It's just life wasn't good. For the most part, and I escaped in video games, and that was a lot of my 20s. And I just decided that I needed to go talk to someone. So I sat down and told my life story for the most part. And then she sat across from me, and I just will never forget this. And she said, "So what do you want me to do for you?" I swear to God. And I sat there like, are you kidding me? That's why I'm here, for you to tell me, you know, to help me. Like, if I knew what I wanted you to do for me, I could probably do it on my own. So I was like, oh, that was it. And then that was the first and last time I saw her. And then when I met my girlfriend, my wife now, girlfriend at the time, you know, I was still volatile, very anxious and all that. You know, God bless my wife. She is just amazing. But so I saw, I'm not sure if it was a psychiatrist or a therapist. I almost said therapist. I went to see her, and I went there about 4 or 5 times. I'm not sure how, was it once a month? I can't remember. But it was about 4 or 5 times, and I spoke to her and I talked about suicidal thoughts, and she was the one, or other various thoughts and things like this. And she said, they're just thoughts. Everybody has them. And that was great to hear someone say, you know, 'cause sometimes we feel so alone. Like, am I the only one that thinks this way? You know? And it's great to just get that. It's great to get that, what is it? That recognition, maybe? I'm not sure what the word is I'm looking for there. But she gave me a prescribed the medication. It was some, for, she thought I had a mood disorder. She gave me medication. And then like after like the fourth or fifth visit, I think where it was only like three or four times, I just decided, you know what? I can do this on my own. And I didn't really need drugs. I've always been someone that thinks I can do everything on my own. I'm quite stubborn. And that's probably why I've been so resilient and why I never committed suicide because, well, I know I don't want to kill myself first off, but I'm going off real off tangent here, but just, I just want to, because I kind of explained that I saw this one psychiatrist before, but I never really explained too much the second one I saw. You know, I just was able to learn how to manage a lot of self-management. And, you know, it's been tough and it wasn't ever a steady road, but finally reaching a point now where suicidal thoughts, and I've said this before, the depression, they're pretty much gone. The suicidal thoughts are, I'm sorry, I've had a lot of energy today and it's all just, I've been trying to harbor it until now. It's about, 10:30 at night. And, now the depression, I'm not sure if that's just gone, or if that's still, you know, I feel like my depression is a chained up beast in a cellar with, you know, with padlocks on it. And once in a while, the beast just bangs away against that door and, you know, maybe rears its ugly head as anger or lack of patience or even just, you know, I don't know. But I'm not to the point where suicidal thoughts they don't really creep up anymore. Pop up, and when I'm in a very frustrated or some kind of mood, and the depression, like I said, I still think it still might be there, but it's not where I don't want to do anything. It's not there in the form of laziness. I don't want to attribute depression or lazy people that they are lazy. But when you're depressed, you don't really want to do anything. Get out of bed. So I've been there. Or a lot of that. So, but I still have anxiety and I still have a lot of nervousness. I don't worry too much, but when it comes to certain things, I can definitely, start to get a little anxious. And my anxiety, it depends. It depends on the mood. You know, if my anxiety is more social anxiety, but not to where, again, it can depend on my mood, but it's not, the social anxiety is more about standing up sometimes in front of strangers or whatever. And let me tell you, YouTube is great. Just getting in front of a camera and has you know, I've grown a lot and learned a lot about myself doing this. And, but also having different jobs and having to do different things with coworkers or presentations and things like that. So it depends. I'm definitely not as anxiety prone as I used to be, but it's still a work in progress for me. I just updated my Twitter and Instagram stupid little description thing that you can just post whatever, and I put on there, just to give people a little, you know, they use those description things. I just put survivor of bullying, depression, and suicidal thoughts, but still working on anxiety. And so I think that's kind of accurate. I definitely get a lot of nervous energy, I try to make sure I harness it and use it in the right way. Not always easy, but hey, I'm human. I'm a work in progress until the day I die. So that's enough about that. I just wanted to touch base. Okay. So, I hope you're doing well. I hope, you're making the best, of each moment and each day, as best as you can. And hopefully if things aren't, doing that great for you now, hopefully they will turn around. You know, life, like Bill Hicks said, life is a roller coaster. It's a ride. And especially when it comes to stuff like that, bad days, good times, it's up and down, you know, enjoy the good times, try to, you know, seize the day and make the most of them, because most likely there's something bad's going to happen at some point. And same with the bad times, you know, hopefully they can turn around. All right, so we're going to start off with The Walking Dead. Get this out of the way, in case you can skip ahead a little bit if you haven't seen it yet. But I talked about this in the last podcast, so if you want to hear my thoughts previously about the saviors and such, you'll have to go to the iTunes or Libsyn website and listen there. But so I just watched it tonight. It's Monday night. So I watched the latest episode, and I thought it was really good. I thought it was quite moving. It had a definitely emotional edge to it. A little bit one of those episodes where they're coming down from all the action and excitement, which is cool, which is, you know, which is needed, I think. Not everyone likes those kind of episodes. And we had, in this episode, it was Eugene, and I forget the guy, the red-haired guy. I don't know why we always say red, but anyway, Abraham. Abraham and Eugene went off. Eugene looking to, I think, looking to make bullets. Although I wonder if part of that was for him trying to come to grips of him living in the post-apocalyptic world with the walkers and him being a survivor, if it was a mix of that and truly trying to go out there and make bullets. I think it might have been a little bit of both for him proving to himself and maybe Abraham. It seemed like a couple folks had something to prove, which was kind of stupid by the end of the episode. People always trying to get themselves and their friends killed. And then we had Daryl and Denise and I forget the other girl's name. They went out again, mostly because of Denise. I think that's her name, right? Because her brother was Dennis. And they were born minutes apart or something like that. And her trying to see if she could... she was trying to, you know, she knew what was going on with the girl, with Abraham leaving her, and what was up with Daryl. You know, it was kind of like a big setup, but she also wanted to get some meds too and all this. So, and once again, it was her trying to find herself or come to grips with her wanting to also be a survivor and see if she could do this, go out there and kill a walker or whatever. And then it took quite a great, interesting turn. Unexpected. I kind of half expected it because someone suggested a hint, even though they know I didn't watch it. They didn't give me too much of a spoiler, but a little bit. And it was, you know, it was just enough for me to be on edge a little bit throughout the what happened in this particular episode. I was somewhat prepared for, so it didn't catch me quite off guard. Whereas if this person didn't mention a little thing, but still the impact and the suddenness of the event was great. I love that in movies when something happens when you least expect it. It's very hard to pull off these days because those typical situations, you know, when to expect something, when there's nothing really going on that you would expect something to happen, they're getting slimmer, I think. You know, we're getting more accustomed to that, to stuff happening out of nowhere. But you know, they still find ways to do that little jump scare. I don't think that'll ever go away. And that was a shock though, what happened. And you know, Daryl stumbles upon that guy from the past, took his bike, and about four or five of them got away. So I'm not sure what's going to come of that. And they know where their survivors live. So apparently they've been scoping them out and whatever, which is not a good thing. We still have whatever's going on with Negan. We have 2 episodes left. And we also have Carol. What's going on with her? And apparently that's going to cause a little bit of a ruckus in the next episode. So something's going to come to a head by the last episode. I don't know with what happened in this episode involving a certain character. I don't know if there will be any more disappearances of any other characters. But something's got to be set up for next year. And I'm kind of thinking it might involve Negan. So definitely this season, this second half has been great. This year has been great. Not really disappointed at all. I can't even remember the first half of the season. in any case, it's been great. And really enjoying it. I hope you're enjoying it too. Feel free to comment on the YouTube channel. If you're listening to this, hop over there. You know, I always read the comments and everything. And suggestions, I always take folks' suggestions into consideration. Can always get to them. So that's it for The Walking Dead. I think I briefly mentioned how I recommend podcasting or doing YouTube if you have something to express yourself. And that's kind of the reason how I started. I have in one of my personal journals, which I don't really update as often anymore, but I updated a lot when our son was much younger. But now that he's older and he can start retaining memories and such, I don't really update it too often. Plus, between being with him, spending time with family, and then doing this, catching up on sleep, trying to read a book, whatever, there's rarely time to put aside to update my journal as much as I used to. But I want to get around to doing that. But in that journal, back in the summer of 2011, before I opened up my channel, about 6-7 months before I found out about ASMR, although I always experienced it, I wrote in that journal something along the lines of that even though I was unhappy with my life creatively, and even though that I wasn't happy with where I was in regards to jobs, that I was very happy and content being a father, and I still am. But then I struggled for a long time trying to figure out what to do with myself creatively. Tried to teach myself guitar, didn't have patience, not really good with the guitar anyway. I taught myself like 6 chords, but I just never had the dexterity, you know, to move around on the frets and all that too well. Tried to dabble in electronic music. Again, just not really much of a composer. You know, I could do a couple of riffs of synthesizers and things like that, but I didn't know anything about bass. I didn't know anything about, you know, applying, you know, everything to master a track. So it was frustrating. I tried a t-shirt job, my wife and I, but that didn't work out too well. Creating t-shirts and all this. So I just decided to look into the Native American flute. I always enjoyed those. And decided to open up a YouTube channel and just to express myself. Thought, I'll give us a try and all that. And got updated our HD camcorder, because we had an old mini DV and we needed something modern so I could record our family and our son. And then that ended up being used for nature videos. And I used that camcorder. Then I found out about ASMR and all the videos in the community. And then I used that camcorder for, you know, the first up till 2014. So the first 500 videos or so, nothing but that camcorder. I think it was that 1080p? I can't remember. I think it was 1080p. And then I used the Zoom H4n at one point, which I purchased the Zoom H4n and binaural microphones even before YouTube and before ASMR. So I was into audio before getting on YouTube. But then, you know, I sold everything, you know, and I didn't need anything anymore. You know, before, at some point I gave up dabbling in that. I wasn't really going anywhere. Got into macro photography of photographing insects. I can never say that the CTS combination too well, but that never went anywhere either. So here I am. So with that, I definitely want to say a huge thank you to all you folks out there. Whoever you are, even if you're just watching, you never comment, just, you know, or if you never press the like button, you just watch. That's fine by me. So I highly recommend if you have something to say, if you have something to express, get on YouTube or make a podcast. You know, we got to do some homework and look into the type of equipment. You know, I really can't recommend, but, there's so many things that you can use, from the low range price range, from the higher end, and check it out. You know, it might be something that you're into. Do it for, you know, but do it for authentic reasons. You know, people are going to do whatever they want for whatever reason. I can't tell you, but I would recommend doing it for authentic reasons. You know, don't do it to look to make money or to build, you know, subscriber base. That's not why I did it. That's not why I'm here. I mean, I'm looking to support myself and all that and yada, yada. But, you know, like with the podcast, I'm never going to have advertising on the podcast. Well, and mostly because, you know, the podcast isn't my main gig. So I don't have anything against folks that do that. But I'm just saying, you know, every avenue, creative avenue that I do is not going to be tied to money. But, you know, just, I'll just recommend, you know, staying true to who you are. And if you're looking to build a channel, just be consistent. You know, when it comes to YouTube, sure, it comes to quality can be key and all that. And, you know, and flash and, you know, and all that, but consistency, you know, 2 to 3 videos a week, I would think, you know, depending on, what you're doing and all that, one video a week, at least if you're looking to really run a channel, I'd say at least one video a week. That's just my opinion. All right. But, give it a try. You never know. It might be something that you enjoy. Check it out. And I always recommend doing something new all the time, trying something new, because it's just how you grow, how you learn more about yourself, how you conquer a lot of things like anxiety. And it's just really, it's great. I can't speak highly enough of that. All right. So moving on, let's talk about marijuana and cannabis and my view on psychoactives. So you may or may not know that I am a supporter of legalizing natural psychoactives, cannabis, peyote, mushrooms, whatever it might be. Now I know certain of those plants have been modified, so they're not quite as natural as maybe when they first grew or what have you. But still I support the educational, moderate and responsible use of them, just like alcohol. Cannabis is known, well, they say that alcohol in moderation actually does have some benefits. And same with cannabis. I mean, there was actually a TED conference where someone spoke about how it cured a kid or something like this of cancer or something along those lines. I don't know if it cures cancer or not, but I'm not really a huge studier. I'm not a huge proponent of cannabis. You know, I'm not, you know, the last time I smoked was a couple years before we had our son. I just wanted my body just to be kind of clean. You know, I don't know if cannabis has a good or bad effect on long-term on the body or if it would have any kind of impact on our son. So I'd say around 2003, around then is when I stopped smoking. I haven't smoked since. So it's been about 13 years. If it ever becomes legal recreationally, you know, I definitely would smoke it again. Or if I'm somewhere, as long as I can do it responsibly, you know, and it's not going to interfere with my being able to be, you know, parent my son. But for me, marijuana, smoking, well, which I actually don't think smoking is a good idea, because I think that what you should be putting in your lungs is air. But I think that I used marijuana because I was so pent up creatively, and I had, you know, being raised Catholic and, you know, having so many rules and everything, just what you can't do, the Ten Commandments and all this, and, you know, being the highly sensitive person that I am, you know, I took a lot of that stuff, just messed with my head. And took a lot for me to, break away from from that dogma and everything. So I had a lot of pent up, you know, just frustrations and things. And I was, anxiety and depression and dealing with, you know, getting picked on and bullied and all that. So it was a great release for me. When I used to get high, I would actually just laugh a lot. Everything was comedy movies were like 1,000 times better. Food was great. Food tasted better. Especially snacks and like Cheetos and chips. It would really intensify in a good way. And I would just have a good time. I know some people used to smoke, they used to get chill. Not me. It would just almost like be like a great rush for me. So the State House of Pennsylvania on March 17th or so, 18th, voted 149-43 for the legislation for medical use of marijuana. And I'm going to take my phone out here real quick. Okay, so this is from the website Normal, Working to Reform Marijuana Laws. And this is from March 21st, Pennsylvania. Amid a long and dispiriting budget battle, Republican state lawmakers and Democratic Governor Tom Wolf found common ground last week, you know, around March 14th or so, on an important bill to expand the arsenal of safe drugs used to combat pain. The House passed a bill to legalize the use of marijuana for medical purposes, 149-43. In the process, representatives rejected a series of poison pill amendments by misguided law and order advocates that would have made the bill impossible to implement in practice. So that's good. That's kind of a messed up bill if you think about it, how there are folks out there who will, you know, try to make amendments to things that can make, you know, impede progress, you know. And that's, I don't want to get into all that. I mean, that's been going on forever. But anyway, Senator Mike Fulmer, a conservative Republican from Lebanon, who helped shepherd a similar bill to passage in the Senate last year, expected that the House and Senate bills would be reconciled and sent to Mr. Wolf, who plans to sign it. And there's opponents argued that the bill should not pass because it would put state law at odds with federal law, under which marijuana still is classified as a Schedule I illegal narcotic. But the federal government long ago stopped prosecution for legitimate medicinal marijuana use. The Pennsylvania bill is highly restrictive. It prohibits the smoking of marijuana for medicinal purposes and limits its prescribed consumption to liquid or food forms. That's pretty much what I'm a proponent of, not smoking it. Also, it establishes strict rules for growing marijuana plants and dispensing the drug. Also, the bill establishes a specific roster of conditions for which the drug may be used. In addition to helping people who need pain relief, use of medical marijuana also could help to stem the opioid overdose epidemic plaguing the state by providing an alternative. Fatal marijuana doses are extremely rare. The bill reflects the experiences of other states and is a compassionate effort to help suffering Pennsylvanians. So I'm all for that, of course, the medical the medical use, but I'm also for the recreational use, because my stance is that you can't ban nature. You can't control what someone does with their body. Doug Stanhope said it best when if there's anything you own, it's your piece of meat, it's your body. And you know, if you want it, you can do whatever you want with it. Now, that's a very simplistic form. Unfortunately, it's the society we live in today. There's these things, these multiple ton vehicles called cars and trucks. We can't have folks driving them intoxicated. Unfortunately, folks still do that every day, every year, when it comes to alcohol, getting behind the wheel, causing accidents and driving drunk. We can't have that with marijuana use either, which brings up a side note in regards to whether we should have ever created vehicles in the first place. Just because we can doesn't mean we should. But we've come too far along now to actually just say, okay, let's get rid of cars and buildings and all this and try to commune and live in nature. That's not exactly how I think we should live, but I think we've come a little too far. But, you know, anyway. So, people already use marijuana illegally anyway. So might as well make it legal at this point for medicinal and recreational use. And when I say recreational, do the same thing like you do with tobacco and alcohol. Put labels on there and start putting more education in schools about everything. We don't have any education much, as far as I know, especially in the higher end elementary schools, lower high schools, you know, when kids are 13, 12, starting to gain more independence, starting to think for themselves a little bit more, starting to explore a little bit more and all that, 15 years old, so 16, whatever. And so not that kids at 12 or 16 should be drinking alcohol or smoking marijuana, but we need to put education out there because 16-year-old kids are going to do it. Probably are doing it. I did it. I'm not the only one. Okay, so let's not act like people don't, or young people don't. And I'm not condoning doing anything illegally, but I'm saying it happens. It's going on right now, whether you like it or not. And we need more education, number one. You just need to educate. How much to use? Body weight. You know, you go into upstairs in our cabinets, we have little bottles of child's cough medicine. I forget what the heck it is. I'm not sure if it's Benadryl or whatever. Anyway, I don't think it's Benadryl. But and in there, when you're, you know, if we want to give our son something to help with his cough or his congestion or his allergies, you get a little dosage. You know, 6 and under, he gets like 1 milliliter. 6 and up, or 6 to 10, whatever, he gets 2 milliliters. And over whatever a certain age, you know, he gets, I don't know, 3 or 4, the whole little cup. It's not very much. You do the same thing. You put marijuana on the counter. You know, you include a pamphlet. I mean, it's this is not very difficult to come up with and do. And you put it in food form, you know, I don't know, marijuana in powder form, make the plants available. You know, they have in the grocery market, there's many in the grocery market. In the supermarkets like Wegmans, they have alcohol, right? So you go get food, you can get alcohol. So they should have another thing with marijuana, cannabis, peyote, mushrooms. And you just got to learn to put laws down, because you can't have someone eating mushrooms and driving a car, right? So, well, maybe you don't sell mushrooms at a place where you got to drive to. I don't know how you do that, okay? I've never had a mushroom. I want to try it someday for the experience of it. In a safe manner, whatever becomes legal. But, you know, you could put different cannabis plants and strains right next to the alcohol, another section, right? Liquid form, powder form, put in there something about, you know, the laws, the dosages, the weight, you know recommend, you know, all this stuff. You should probably sell it right next to the snacks, because you would just, you know. I bet, just think about this. If they ever made it legal, yeah, you could be at the baseball game, right, and guy selling hot dogs and soda and popcorn, he'd be like, get your marijuana here, marijuana, get your cannabis here. I can't think of any strains right now, get your white rhino here. I can't I think of what other strains there are right now. There's like purple kush, right? Kush. I don't even know how to say it, man. I'm so out of the loop. But get your purple kush here. Purple kush. And right? I mean, that's what, if this was legal, you can get beer. So why can't you get marijuana? I'm watching the game, man. That'd be awesome. There would be like no fights. Might as well sell at selling at the grocery store. And you know, I can picture at some point in time, you go buy a bag of you know, whatever, purple kush. I don't even know how to say that again. And on there it says, you know how they have those coupons on different things that you buy, save a dollar off next time? You put right on there, you have the marijuana strain company. Then you have the Dorito company, the Doritos, right? And on the marijuana, it would say like save a dollar off Doritos. You know, I mean, you know how the snack industry would just go through the roof, man. And then on the Doritos, it'd say save a dollar off your favorite strain of marijuana, man. I mean, right? People are going to legalize it. I mean, they don't do that now with alcohol, you know, really. Like, you don't go buy, you know, some bottle of wine. They don't have a coupon on there for your favorite cheese or vice versa. But, you know, it's just really silly. A lot of things that we do as humans to try to control what, you know, we're control freaks. A lot of, really, we are. We're control freaks. Got to control what everybody does. And I have a huge problem with. And because you just can't. The human being is it's like a free radical. It's a product of nature. You can't control it. There's no instructions. It's not a robot. We're an organic robot, probably, if you can figure out whatever consciousness is. But you just can't control the human beings. We can put laws in there. I'm kind of for laws or some kind of regulation so that people just don't run around stealing and killing and all that. That's not good either. So you got to find a good balance. And we kind of have that here. I don't go around looking to break laws. I wake up. Unfortunately, you know, we all got to do whatever we got to do to make money so we can have a place to stay and eat. So a lot of laws don't, you know, they apply to me, but, you know, I'm not doing anything to break laws, so I'm pretty free for the most part. I think we do a lot better. I think there's always room for improvement. Yeah, I'm all for it, you know, legalization of marijuana, cannabis, all the psychoactives, natural occurring psychoactives, like I said. As long as you have the proper education and moderate use, and why not? If we're going to allow people that suffer with pain, well, there's people that suffer with anxiety and depression that might help. Just because you don't have a physical thing. Now, I'm not sure what the rules and the guidelines are in Pennsylvania or every state. I'm not sure if anxiety or depression are covered. Just let the people do what they want, but just put some rules in there and regulations as far as what they can't do. I mean, they're already doing what they want anyway. So, you know, it's just, you know, but it's good. We're making progress. And I'm just looking at some notes here on a piece of paper. I don't really think I have anything else I wanted to talk on that subject. Yeah. So, and I've had a video before where I talked about it. I'm pretty much repeating the same thing. There's not really much else to say, you know. You just let people do what they want, as long as it's not harming anybody else. That even before I came on YouTube around 2000 or something like that, my own personal philosophy is like the basis, the cornerstone probably of my personal philosophy is we are all free, living, free-willed, free creatures to do whatever we want so long as it doesn't hinder upon anyone else's freedom. That means I can do what I want, drive my car as fast as I want, if I want to get drunk and all this, so long as it's not going to harm someone or put someone in danger and all that. And that's why we have laws in regards to not driving while influenced, but there's a lot of laws and a lot of things that are illegal, like smoking marijuana, which is just kind of silly. Just make it free, make people allowed to do it, but tailor that, you know, tailor certain things that they can't do, you know, and that kind of ties in with prison system and everything. We need more education about the prison system. I know a lot of people think I'm voting for Bernie or I'm riding off the tailwind of Bernie Sanders or whatever, but I've been thinking this stuff even before I heard of Bernie Sanders. Before Bernie Sanders, I knew about Noam Chomsky. I'm not a huge, I don't know a lot about all these people, but I know enough of them. I've been saying this stuff for years. I've been saying this stuff even before YouTube. So, you know, these are all the conclusions that I've come to that just seem to make a lot of sense. Very rational. I'm a person of reason and logic. I am also someone that is a creative and all that, but I can be very rational, reasonable, and just make sense. Just, you know, you may not like it. You know, you may not like religious people or atheists, but they have a freedom. They have the right here in the United States to be atheists or Muslims or practice Judaism or Christianity, so long as it doesn't harm anyone else. Same thing with alcohol and marijuana. You may not like it, but other people have the right to do it, and that's what's supposed to be. That's what's supposed to, you know, America. I want to say, let's make America great again. America's already great. We're making it worse, or we're not helping our progress. And we're progressing as far as like same-sex marriages. That's great, but we still have a lot of room to expand and spiral out. So that's it. I'm all for the psychoactives, you know, recreationally as well as medicinally. And hopefully we can and get to that point, you know. Just, we need to grow up as a species, you know. We really do. All right. So the next thing I wanted to talk about is philosophy. And first off, there's a podcast that I want to recommend called Philosophize This. I've only listened to two episodes right now. I think there's one person that runs it. I don't know. There's at least 70 episodes. There may be 90. I'm not sure if it's weekly, biweekly. Definitely recommend that. Philosophy, I've always been a person to think. At some point, being raised Roman Catholic and going to Catholic school for 12 years from kindergarten up to grade 12 of high school, went to Catholic school. And at some point, I decided to check out. And I just, you know, I did enough to pass. You know, I studied enough. I cheated on tests, you know, plus all the crap that I went through as a kid in high school. High school shouldn't exist. High school is not a very fun time for a lot of kids going through puberty, dealing with a lot of things. It's just, I don't know. I don't know how you address high school. I don't think it's, for a lot of folks, it's not very fun. I mean, you do meet some good friends and stuff, but I mean, there's, I don't know if it's 50-50, good and bad times. But that's my perspective, and I know some other folks out there share that same perspective. But I've always been a thinker, and I have an ego to consider myself a philosopher. You know, I think you got to write, you got to come up with your own philosophy, and all that. But I like to philosophize, and I like to think and come to my own. I got my own personal philosophy. Come bits and pieces of everyone else, which is what pretty much how most philosophers are. You know, they learn from all those from before them. They learn life experiences and they come up with their own little thing. And so, but I never really fully explored philosophy much. I went on the internet and all that, but I never really picked up any philosopher's books like Socrates or, you know, Friedrich Nietzsche. Whose book I have right here and I'm holding up to the camera in case you're just listening podcast. Thus Spoke Zarathustra. It's actually in the public domain. I didn't have to buy it, but for some reason I like to have a book. Gives me a chance to, something about books I like to have in the physical format. I like to, it could be, I think, a tradition maybe, but I like to take a book and It's a way to escape and get away from electronic, the electronic mediums all the time as well. Because they're too distracting. Sitting there reading a book on a Kindle, I'd be too preoccupied also with wanting to surf or something like that. So it's, but anyway, so I decided, you know, I delved into nihilism, and lately I've been learning, trying to understand cynicism a little bit more, the true philosophical meaning of cynicism. And there's a modern connotation, which means you're very distrusting of people and all this stuff. And you can look at it on Wikipedia, but the word originated from the true philosophical meaning of cynicism, which is that you reject, I wrote a little thing here, my paper here that I have in front of me, true cynicism, the philosophy and where it originated from is the ancient Greek philosophers who rejected all conventions and religion and manners, and advocated pursuit of virtue in accordance with a simple and idealistic way of life. Also somewhat in accordance with nature. And I've always been that way, even before I understood the true meaning of cynicism. You might know me. I'm very into nature. I've always been of the mindset that less is more, a simple way of life. I've rejected rejected religion. I always don't care about manners, you know, and try to live as free as possible. And definitely I love to be unconventional. So I can definitely relate to the true meaning of cynicism. I'm not going to consider myself a true cynicist because, you know, I still have worldly possessions, but the possessions I have are really, for me, are like what are paints were to Bob Ross, or guitar and strings to a guitar player, musician. Those are my tools, my palette. I don't own a watch. I own one pair of jeans. I own like two or three pairs of shoes, one that I wear all the time. I don't even own a watch, things like that. So I'm not, you know, I acquire a lot of things, not too ridiculously. You know, I don't even have an umbrella for my lights. I have a clamp light with a CFL bulb, and I have wax paper wrapped around it to help, you know, so it's not so harsh. I'm looking to do what I can in a very kind of punk rock kind of way, I guess you would say. It's been working for me, and I try to, you know, improve things here or there, but, if I was making a movie, that would be different, you know. I still think you can make a good movie on a decent budget. You know, it all depends on what you're going for. There's so many different folks making movies in so many different ways. It doesn't always need to have a $1 million budget and fancy this and fancy that and all that. So I want to learn more about cynicism. I definitely can relate to it. I know we can also confuse cynicism with skepticism or even pessimism. Pessimism is just a complete negative outlook on life. That's not me. I may have been quite pessimistic growing up in the past, but I think I was more cynical. Today, I am cynical. I'm not completely distrustful of people, but while I am cynical, and sometimes I wonder if we're ever going to truly progress, because we do a lot of vile things as a species, a lot of vile things. You may be aware or not, you know, there's the sex trade. There's just vile things, you know, extremist groups and all this. All right. So we have that dark shadow that just seems to follow us. Middle Ages, torture, burning witches at the stake, slavery. And now we have all the dark side still that persists today. Skepticism is pretty much disputing claims made by people that don't have any empirical knowledge to back up their beliefs or opinions. So that's a skeptic. A cynic is someone that distrusts others' motives and has a lack of faith and hope in human species, which I have sometimes. But I know what people are capable of, and I know we can do better, and I know we can progress as a society. Definitely that's who I am. I can relate to being cynical, but I know what we're capable of. Man, I know what the human race is capable of. Look at our technology, advances in medicine, even though I have a love-hate relationship with technology based on the power that it uses and consumes and all that. I can't complain. You know, here I am with all this technology around me, but born into the society, you know? I'm now on this little journey of mine because I want to talk more about, I want to not only understand philosophy more, not only, it's like I equate this little philosophical journey that I'm going on now, where I'm going to be reading different philosophers' books and such, as owning a guitar and teaching myself a few chords and saying, yeah, I own a guitar, I play the guitar, but never... and saying, oh yeah, I love Jimi Hendrix, he's great, but never trying to attempt to learn how Jimi Hendrix played or understand or read the music, or even, you know, try to develop my ability to play the guitar even further. Just taught myself six chords on the guitar. Yeah, I'm a guitar player, you know, and try to act like I know what I'm talking about. While I do know what I'm talking about in a philosophical sense, I mean, you don't really need to teach yourself too much, really, to be able to think and to come to your own conclusions and all this stuff. It helps a lot to gain more perspective and to see what people have thought before, to say, oh, you know what? That's how I think, you know? I purchased Friedrich Nietzsche's Thus Spoke Zarathustra, which is supposed to be his greatest work, or one of his greatest works. Definitely, from what I understand, is... a huge part of culture, and I think philosophy as well, and all this, and you know, he's all about nihilism, and there's a lot you can. I'm not an expert on Nietzsche. I'm not looking to become an expert or a student of Nietzsche. I want to just understand one thing that he's written, try to take from it what I can, share it with you, and then move on to the next philosopher. I'm looking to pick up Marcellus Aurelius's book titled Meditations. He was a Roman emperor, also a philosopher. That seems very interesting. I definitely want to pick up something by, like, maybe Socrates or something else. I want to, you know, not go into like a dozen different philosophers, but definitely some of the ones that contributed a lot, so that I can just understand more, and for personal growth, and, you know, so that I can talk about it and all that. Just want to share that with you. And I find Thus Spoke Zarathustra so far to be quite on the, as someone had tweeted, it's in reply to me asking, I had asked on my Twitter account if anyone has read this book, and not too many responses, which, you know, I'm not trying to tout the fact, like, well, look at me, I'm reading Nietzsche and all this. That's not why I do things. Someone said, you know, it's a bit wordy. So yeah, Friedrich Nietzsche, he definitely wrote this in a narrative style, in a more somewhat poetic style. It's very creative style, where he took his own philosophy, his own beliefs, and all this, and did it in a narrative, telling it through another character, so to speak. The writing is definitely old style type of writing. I can give you a sample of the writing here. The values of 1,000 years glitter on those scales, and thus speaketh the mightiest of all dragons. All the values of things glitter on me. All values have already been created, and all created values do I represent. Verily, there shall be no I will any more. Thus speaketh the dragon. So it's kind of like that old style of writing. I don't know how you would say it. I think it's a creative style. It seems like, I'm not sure if that's actually how they spoke back then. I don't really think so. But I find it interesting so far. I don't really have much to talk about yet because I still got to read it and wrap my head around it and everything like that. So, but hopefully I can come up with a summary and a gist and highlight some things that might speak to me and share them. So that's where I am in regards to the philosophy and where I'm headed. And hopefully anyone out there, again, feel free to chime in, you know, leave a comment. You don't have to. If you just watch these or you just listen, hey, that's fine. Don't worry about it. You can always send me a private message. So yeah, you know, I always enjoy thinking and try to understand the world more, try to understand my own mind more, try to understand people, just have a more broader understanding of life. That's pretty much it. So that is all. And I do want to speak a little bit on family, running over time here. Real quick, I want to touch on free education. I think I mentioned that in the beginning of the podcast. I want to touch on that. And I think education should be free at all levels. I don't think there should be tuition or student loans and all this and putting people into debt. And a lot of folks end up getting a degree and it only ends up being a piece of paper and doing something completely different in life. Meanwhile, the folks that got that money, you know, they're making out, right? So now you can't just flip a switch. I understand this. You can't just flip a switch and give free education. And again, this is not, you know, I'm not riding on the coattails of Bernie Sanders. I've thought about this for a decade at least. You can't just flip a switch and make education free, right? There's not in this society with capitalism and everything, right? Like, we need teachers. They need to eat. You need the tools of the trade to be taught. Time takes, resources and all that, right? So I understand that, okay? But education should still be freely accessible for anyone without having to go into debt. You just can't flip a switch and make it free. And you can't, I know there's people that might think, well, you know, you can't have it. There's gotta be a way. My whole thing is it's just one gear in this system that we live in that needs to be changed. You need to take out the gear of how education is you buy for, you put in a new one, and it's not going to work with all the other gears that currently work with capitalism and everything. It's going to just grind the system to a halt. So you got to fix the other gears and replace those gears. And that means the economic system or how it's a complete overhaul. I'm going to keep this short. You know, I see education as one of the leaks in the pipe. We live in a house, we live in an apartment complex, and there's pipes, and one of the pipes are leaking causing someone's house, someone's room in this apartment complex, someone's apartment, you know, to have stained walls or leak in the ceiling. And there's all different pipes and they all have different leaks. And I just see the system that we live in, society, that is, it's okay. Needs improvement, but it has a lot of leaks, and a lot of things are broken. And I think this is one way to address a broken education system. Which, I mean, I can just see the people out there, kids. I mean, there are kids, and this is no lie. This is truth. After now being a parent and having a kid in school, there are kids, and there are families out there that cannot afford books. For their kids, can afford some of the, and we have libraries and things like that, and parents can rent books, all that for free, and that's great. But there's like school books that parents may not be able to afford, and there's just regular books that kids might want to own that parents can afford. I mean, we live in that kind of society. That is a reality. Not everyone can afford a lot of the things that other families can afford, which puts them ahead. I mean, you're more educated. Knowledge is power. I mean, let's not pretend. You know, we should have a society that wants its citizens, its people, to advance and reach their highest potential, because who knows how they will benefit society in return. How many young Einsteins are out there who are in prison right now because the society has failed them, or they've been disenfranchised, whatever, okay? And that's real, all right? What I'm saying is just real. This is not all fantasy, all right? People can say it better than I can, and I'm probably regurgitating some of that stuff, but how do you not want your people on this planet, to have the utmost potential to reach their highest potential, to help advance society and come up with new ideas and new ways and all this, but people just struggle. It's just ridiculous, and I'm ranting right now, but that's my thing on free education. We should offer it. It can happen. But you need a whole system change. It's not just one gear, swap a gear out in the same system. That's not going to work. It's like putting in a nice brand new pipe. The rest of the pipes are still leaking, you know? So that's my rant there and my stance on that. Family, I wanted to talk about family, the cost and time of running a family. I want to save that for next podcast. I'm already over an hour here, so... and I also wanted to talk about different people in different relationships and the pros and cons of different relationships and how we shouldn't compare our lives if we feel inadequate and we see how someone else appears to always be happy and all that, which no one is always happy. But so I'll talk about that too. So, all right, that's all I got. Stay tuned for another videos as always. I'm not sure if the Arkham Sanitarium podcast will get out because of upcoming issues, but it might go out a couple days later than normal. Other than that, thanks for tuning in as always. Thanks as always for your support. And I wish you all my best on your own journey in life with each path that you take. And I hope if things aren't going too well right now, they turn around for you sooner than later. Take care and wish you all my best. Peace.